Okay, so first of all, what do we actually mean by an exotic superconductor? Well, crudely speaking, we define it, as it were, by a negative. It is a superconductor which, in one way or another, is not like the classic superconductors, so-called BCS superconductors, with which we were familiar for many years, and in fact, which until roughly 1975 we thought were the only kinds of superconductors around. So if you look at essentially all the superconductors which were known before 1975, and remember that goes back a long time because the discovery of superconductivity was 1911, they really have quite a few characteristics in common. First of all, the transition temperature is never above 25K. Now, I put here except BKBO and magnesium diboride, and the reason for that is that these are thought to be essentially superconductors of the classic class. However, they were discovered later than 1975. So they do have transition temperatures rather higher. Magnesium diboride in particular has a transition temperature way up about 40K. But as I say, for what I think are fairly good reasons, they are usually regarded as simply rather outlying members of the class of classic superconductors. The second point is that the normal state of the classic superconductors is usually rather well described by Fermi liquid theory. Remember that's the theory due to Landau, which is essentially a theory of a classic non-interacting electron gas in a crystalline lattice with some complications and so forth. But basically the qualitative behavior is much the same as in the sort of textbook model of a gas of non-interacting electrons sitting in some kind of crystalline lattice band structure. Third thing that all the pre-1975 classic superconductors have in common is that at least as far as we know, and I think there's pretty good evidence for this, the mechanism of Cooper fair formation is exactly what BCS said it was, that is, an attraction induced by the exchange of virtual phonons. Fourthly, the symmetry of the pairs in the classic superconductors is always S-wave. In other words, it's a spin singlet, it's isotropic in orbital space, or at least it's as isotropic as the lattice will allow it to be in orbital space. So those features, I think one can say with some confidence, are common to all the classic superconductors. There are other features which appear to be at least very common, if not totally universal, in the old-fashioned classic superconductors. The structure is usually essentially three-dimensional. That's not true, incidentally, of BKBO and magnesium diboride. That's an interesting point, which hopefully I may be able to come back to later. So the highest temperature superconductors in the classic class are not actually three-dimensional. The superconducting state is usually not close to any other broken symmetry phase, for example, to an antiferromagnetic phase. And in the case of alloys, the superconductivity is usually not particularly sensitive to the stoichiometry. Now, the exotic superconductors lack at least one of these features, and in many cases more than one. The cuprates, in fact, lack all of these seven features, so they are the most exotic, if you like, of the exotic superconductors. Probably in the next lecture, I'll show you a table which show exactly which of these properties are and are not maintained for various classes of exotic superconductor. Okay, so as I said, an exotic superconductor fails to satisfy at least one of these seven conditions, and in many cases more than one. How do we actually tell that? Well, going back for a moment, 1, 5, 6, and 7, that was, okay, obviously that we can tell directly from experiment, similarly this, this, and this. As to 2, well, we can basically read that off from experiment plus a little theory, okay? Fermi liquid theory does make very well-defined predictions for the properties of the normal state. For example, that the Pauli spin susceptibility should be constant, the specific heat should be roughly linear in T, et cetera, and we can check those for these exotic superconductors. Now, 3 and 4 are a little more tricky. 3 and 4, 3 was that the mechanism of Cooper pair formation is phonon-induced, and 4 was the symmetry. And okay, so we need to say a little about how we actually read off, or try to read off, those properties from experiment, and that's not quite so simple. How do you diagnose a non-phonon mechanism? Well, a very famous observation in the history of classic superconductivity was the observation of the so-called isotope effect. If I take a given classic superconductor, like say aluminum or lead, and I look at compare the superconducting properties of different isotopes of this material, then what I find is that there is apparently a systematic dependence of the transition temperature on the isotopic mass. And in fact, that's best expressed in terms of d log T by d log M. That's usually called alpha, the isotope exponent. Now, in naive BCS theory, as they originally developed it, alpha is always a half. And that does seem to be relatively well confirmed for many of the classic superconductors, though, as we'll see, not all. Following BCS, a few years later, a number of people did more sophisticated calculations of the isotope effect, in particular Macmillan. And Macmillan produced a formula, which I haven't reproduced in detail, which basically says that alpha is a half times this factor here, where if is a function of two things. It's a function of the strength of the electron phonon coupling, and it's a function of the renormalized Coulomb interaction. In the Macmillan approach, this quantity F is always greater than zero. It's often much less than one, but it can in principle be even greater than one. Crudely speaking, the conclusion which you would draw from this analysis is that if alpha is 0.5, then that is at least consistent with phonon mediation, and in fact suggests rather strongly that that's what you're seeing. Anything else would, as it were, have to be in some sense a coincidence, because in general, non-phonon theories don't give you a particular isotope exponent, or if they do, it's more precisely, if you don't involve the phonons, then there's no way to get an isotope exponent other than zero. So if alpha is much less than 0.5, that would suggest that you have a non-phonon mediated superconductivity. However, you can't be quite certain of that, because in fact the Macmillan analysis does allow alpha much smaller than 0.5, even for phonon mediation. And there are in fact one or two known cases, I think vanadium is one of them, where superconductors which are otherwise classic do have a very small isotope exponent. One thing's for sure, if alpha is not zero, then the phonons have to be making some kind of contribution somehow, because there's no other way in which the isotopic mass could enter. Second point about phonon mediation, if you do generalization of the BCS theory, which is originally due to Eli Ashberg, then it turns out that any peaks in the phonon density of states, which is something you can measure directly, say by neutron scattering, must be reflected, admittedly in a slightly indirect way, but one can actually do a quantitative theory of this. These peaks must be reflected in the superconducting state tunneling conductance, which is the ratio of the differential conductance in the superconducting state relative to the normal state. That's a very informative quantity, and lots and lots of measurements were made on classic superconductors of this quantity. And indeed, it was found that for most of the classic superconductors, this reflection did come out exactly as predicted. This was the famous work of Macmillan and Roel in the 60s. So one thing one can certainly say is that if you don't find such a reflection of these characteristics, then the phonons can't be playing an important role, and the superconductivity must be due to some kind of non-photonic mechanism. So let's go on then to the question of how do you diagnose non-S S-wave pairing? Well, we have to say a little about definitions here. Let's try to give a general definition of the order parameter, and we'll assume it's going to be, we're going to be talking about time-independent states. The two-particle density matrix, I haven't written out explicitly the definition of the two-particle density matrix, but essentially, you remember that we define the one-particle density matrix as the, in some sense, the best description we can get of the properties of a single particle averaged over the behavior of all the n-1 others. Well, similarly, the two-particle density matrix is the best description we can get of the behavior of two particles averaged over the n-2 others. Now, again, just as in the case of the one-particle density matrix, that's a Hermitian quantity. We can therefore express it in canonical form in terms of its eigenvalues and eigenfunctions here. And in principle, there are three possibilities. First of all, it may be that all the eigenvalues, n sub I, are of order 1. Example of that is simply the free Fermi gas. And you can actually work out quite explicitly in that case exactly what the possible a possible choice of eigenvalues and eigenfunctions are. I say a possible choice because, in fact, you have a very high degree of degeneracy here. Certainly, you can work out one possible choice. Second possibility, a slightly exotic one, is that two or more eigenvalues are of order n, that is the total number of particles, but the rest are all of order 1. That's a situation which is not often considered. Sometimes it's called fragmented BEC or pseudo-BEC. So it's usually believed to be not terribly relevant to real superconductivity. However, there are some circumstances, which I will come back to in a later lecture in this course, where one may have to worry about that situation. Finally, the case which is relevant, believed to be relevant to real superconductivity, is you have a single eigenvalue of your two-particle density matrix, which is of order n, and the rest are all of order 1. So in some sense, you've got a sort of pseudo-BEC of pairs of particles, and this is what we traditionally call Cooper pairing. In this case, we can then label the special state 0, and let's now use a capital N for the occupation number of that state. So N sub 0 is now the eigenvalue associated with that state. We can define a two-particle order parameter by this expression here. This quantity here, the chi-0, is nothing but the particular eigenvalue, the particular eigenfunction which is associated with the macroscopic eigenvalue. And root n0 is just the square root of that eigenvalue. And this, again, I emphasize, is a perfectly good definition of the order parameter for the superconducting case. You remember that we had a similar definition of the order parameter for the case of single particle BEC. Now, you notice that from the orthonormality condition on the chi's, you actually have this relation here. So n sub 0 can be regarded as simply the number of Cooper pairs. And I think, the question of what you mean by the number of Cooper pairs is in some sense a matter of definition, but I think this is the most sensible definition and the most realistic one. And what is interesting is that in real superconductors, this is often much less than the total number of particles. It doesn't have to be. There's no general theorem that in a Fermi system that has to be true. In fact, in the ultra-cold atomic gas, ultra-cold atomic Fermi gases, you find that N0 can be indeed of order of N. But in real superconductors, it always seems to be much less than N, typically by a factor of 10 to the minus 3 or so, 10 to the minus 4. Incidentally, just a note, because you may meet this in the literature, an alternative definition of F is this matrix element of two-particle operators between the n-particle ground state and the n plus 2-particle ground state. This is often abbreviated in this fashion, so you regard this as an average. If you really believe that that has a non-zero value, then of course you have to implicitly assume that the number of particles is not conserved, and again, that's not something I like, it's something I'll come back to later. But this is very, very, it's very common in the literature, that's why I mention it. Okay, so now let's define a center of mass and relative coordinate. And then our order parameter is going to be a function of those and of the two spins involved. And we'll usually be interested in the case where F is essentially independent of the center of mass coordinate. Now, in fact, in a crystal, it probably isn't, but that's a sort of relatively technical complication we'll come back to in a moment. So when you talk about the symmetry of the order parameter, then what we mean is the dependence of this order parameter F on the relative coordinate of the Cooper pair and the two spins involved. Okay? Now, in fact, in a crystal, as I said, because of the effect of the lattice potential, it's not strictly correct to assume that F has to be independent of the center of mass coordinate. So what is often useful is to restrict ourselves for the moment to the case where a single band intersects the Fermi surface. That, in fact, this will not be quite the case with respect to some of the superconductors we're going to consider. So we do have to come back to that point eventually. But let's, for the moment, assume that just a single band is intersecting the Fermi surface, and you take the Fourier transform of F in the Bloch basis. And then what we get is, with the sort of standard textbook notation, we get this, an F alpha beta of K. And that has to satisfy the Fermi antisymmetry condition. So F alpha beta of K has to be minus F beta alpha. Now you can classify possible forms of F according to their parity. So you've got this relation here. Remember, this is now alpha beta, not beta alpha here. And now, from Fermi statistics, if the parity is even, you have a spin singlet case, and if the parity is odd, you have a spin triplet case. I should emphasize, you may find in certain cases that you get mixing of these two. And that tends to happen when the spin orbit effects are very important. And that may be true for, particularly for those superconductors containing heavy elements. Remember, the spin-orbit interaction increases very fast with the nuclear charge. So generally speaking, you find it's for the heavy superconductors containing heavy elements, like, say, those heavy fermions which contain uranium, where you have mixing of these two possibilities. But for the moment, let's consider the case where you've got one or the other. So in the spin singlet case, you've got F alpha beta of K is alpha beta of minus k, and in fact the spin structure is given by this. So okay, you've just got a spin function here, the spin singlet, multiplying f of k, and this is the most general case of a singlet. Now the triplet case, unfortunately, is more complicated. That's been very well analysed in the case of helium-3, which is believed to form Cooper pairs in a spin triplet state, and a convenient way of dealing with the order parameter, of expressing it in the case of spin triplet pairing, is to define this beast here, which does not, at first sight, have any particularly intuitive significance. And indeed, in general, if D is some kind of complex quantity, then it's slightly indirect to try to interpret. But if D of K is real, actually, then it has a relatively intuitive significance. What D means is the following. In general, if I'm dealing with spin triplet pairing of particles of spin a half, then I have three possible states. I can pair with up-up, I can pair with down-down, but I can also pair with the symmetric combination of down-up plus up-down. Remember, the minus sign, as here, gives you the singlet, but if you have a plus sign, then it's spin triplet. Okay. So now it turns out that in the case where D is real, you can always find at least one particular direction in space such that you only, direction in spin space, such that if I sit at a given point on the Fermi surface, then the pairs can always be said to form this symmetric triplet state. That is, S equals 1, SZ equals 0. Along some particular axis, and that axis, by definition, is along the direction of D. The magnitude of D is basically a measure of the amplitude of the pairing in that direction. But remember that, in general, D may depend on the direction in which you are on the Fermi surface. That's a nasty complication. Those of you who know about helium-3 will know that it gives rise to various interesting effects. Luckily, we won't have to deal with this very much in the case of the exotic superconductors, but it's just worth bearing in mind. Okay, the question of orbital symmetry is, I think, particularly interesting. Now, here we have a problem. We've defined a quantity F sub k, which is related to the actual wave function of the Cooper pairs. It really is the Fourier transform of the wave function of the Cooper pairs. Now, in BCS theory, this quantity Fk is given by an expression of the form delta k over 2 Ek. Delta k here is the energy gap, it's the gap in the fermionic spectrum. That is independent of the, generally speaking in BCS theory, that's independent of the modulus of k. So if you believe that something like this is still true in the more general case, then what you're interested in is mostly the dependence of Fk on the direction on the Fermi surface. You're not very much interested in its dependence on the modulus of k. And then the possible forms of F sub k are classified by their transformation properties under the crystal symmetry operations. And of course, these are going to be different depending on what particular superconductor you're talking about, because you're going to have different crystal symmetries. But generally speaking, they will involve reflection, rotation, and so forth, usually particular rotation, say by pi over 2. Generally speaking, you find that the order parameter transforms according to a single irreducible representation of the crystal point group. And if this is the identity representation, I'll come back to this in a slightly more less technical language in a moment. If this is the identity representation, then we say we have a conventional or S-wave superconductor. Otherwise, it's exotic. Okay, let's just go back and try to express this in slightly simpler language. Suppose, for example, that I have a cubic crystal. Then I have certain kinds of symmetry operation under which I know my Hamiltonian must be invariant, for example, reflection in a particular crystal axis, or rotation through a pi over 2 between the different crystal axes. Now, if my order parameter remains invariant under those transformations, then I say it's conventional, S-wave. If it changes, whether it changes by sign or putting in some extra phase or perhaps even a different amplitude, then it's exotic. So how do we diagnose these things? Well, first of all, the spin state. This is relatively straightforward. First diagnostic is the spin susceptibility, which you can measure via the so-called night shift. That's the shift in the nuclear resonance frequency due to interaction with the conduction electrons. And generally speaking, in the normal state, this spin susceptibility is, in the classic superconductors, it's constant. We find in most of the exotic superconductors, even if it's not constant, it's not very, very sharply varying in the normal phase. So essentially, we can say that's constant. Now, when we go into the superconducting state, various things may happen. Okay, so for a singlet, it's predicted by BCS theory and also seen experimentally in most cases that susceptibility falls smoothly to zero at zero temperature. For a so-called ESP state, I've cannibalized this from other talks. I haven't explained what an ESP state is. An ESP state is a triplet state such that you can always find a set of axes that no matter where you are on the Fermi surface, it's always up, or down, okay? That's a rather special kind of spin triplet state, but we believe that it may be relevant to certain exotic superconductors. And if that's the case, and if moreover the ESP axes are along the field, which means, there's a technicality, but that means that the vector D is perpendicular to the field, then chi n is essentially constant as I go into the superconducting state. And for a non-ESP triplet, in general, you're going to find that the susceptibility goes down, but does not go down to zero. So at least in principle, by looking at the behavior of the susceptibility, you can infer something about the spin state. If chi at zero temperature is not equal to zero, then it's likely to be a triplet state. If it is zero, then it's a singlet or maybe an ESP triplet with with D parallel to H. That's another possibility. Okay. Unfortunately, for various reasons, it's not always easy to disentangle the spin susceptibility from the total susceptibility of the sample. So it's nice to have a second way of trying to work out the spin state. And this is can be done in the following way. Generally speaking, in a typical superconductor, and in particular a typical classic superconductor, the maximum critical field which the superconductor can sustain, the so-called HC2, the upper critical field, is largely due, almost overwhelmingly due, to orbital effects. That is, the magnetic field will try to bend the trajectories, as it were, of your Cooper pairs. The Cooper pairs don't like that, and eventually they sort of give up and say, OK, we'd rather go back to the normal state. However, it turns out that for extreme type 2 superconductors, the Meissner, this so-called Meissner HC2, is extremely large. Typically, for example, for the cuprates, it can be of the order of hundreds of Tesla at zero temperature. In those circumstances, it may turn out that the actual HC2 is limited by spin effects. And this works roughly in the following way. In zero magnetic field, my two Fermi surfaces for up and down were identical, so it's very easy to take a particle with spin up sitting at one side of the Fermi surface and pair it with a particle spin down on the other side. Okay. Now, in the case, when I have a large magnetic field, however, imagine that I've polarized my normal state so that I've now got this picture here. Here is the upspin Fermi surface, here's the downspin Fermi surface. Now you see, I cannot simultaneously get my two particles to have equal and opposite momentum and at the same time be close to the Fermi surface. So that's going to be energetically disadvantageous. It will disfavor the formation of Cooper pairs, provided I'm trying to form a spin singlet. If I'm trying to form a spin triplet, however, this doesn't matter. Because for spin triplet, I just pair this guy with a downspin over here and this guy with an upspin over here. So crudely speaking, you expect that the spin effects may limit HC2 in the case of spin singlet pairing, but not in general for spin triplet pairing. So in other words, if you don't find a Clogston-Chandrasekhar limit on HC2 where you expect it to, then it's very probably triplet. If you do find a limit, then it's either singlet, or again, triplet maybe with D parallel to H. But you can certainly infer something from this. And this has actually been quite useful in practice. Now, what about diagnostics of the orbital state? Here you have to be rather careful. Generally speaking, if the order parameter transforms according to, if the order parameter is exotic, then, well, we have to be careful, but very typically, it's likely to have nodes on the Fermi surface. That is, there are going to be points where the order parameter actually changes sign as I go around the Fermi surface. However, the converse is not quite true. That is, the fact that I get nodes does not necessarily imply that the order parameter is exotic. Here is a perfectly good order parameter, which is S-wave. You see, it transforms under the symmetry operations of the crystal, like inversion or rotation through pi over 2. It transforms into itself. Nevertheless, it still manages to have nodes. So the mere fact that you have nodes doesn't necessarily imply that the order parameter is exotic. Second very important point, and I think this is something people haven't really worried about as much as they should. The order parameter, F sub k, is a direct measure. It directly refers to the Cooper pair wave function. So it refers to, as it were, the bosonic aspects of superconductivity. On the other hand, the energy gap delta k is the gap in the fermionic energy spectrum. It's a fermionic quantity. Now, it turns out and this is not obvious, but it does turn out that within BCS theory, the these two quantities are very closely proportional. In fact, FK is simply delta K over 2 EK, where EK is the excitation energy of the state K. However, in a general theory, that need not no longer be true. Nevertheless, it would seem somehow very counterintuitive if the actual symmetry properties of FK were very different from those of delta K. So generally speaking, we're going to assume that as regards the symmetry properties, we can basically talk indifferently about F sub K or delta sub K. As I say, but one must bear this caution in mind. So how are we going to determine then the orbital symmetry? Okay, the nicest method, I think, maybe I'm prejudiced, but the nicest method to determine the F sub K is to measure it directly by Josephson experiments. And crudely speaking, these work in the following way. Imagine that you have a traditional squid. Then the you've got an external current which is trying to flow through this device. And here you have two Josephson junctions. They're sitting in parallel here. And there's a sort of a relation which says that the phase drop of your Cooper pairs across one junction is related to the one across the second junction with these different conventions by 2 pi phi over phi zero, where phi is the external flux trapped to the loop. And therefore, the critical current, it should be an I sub C here, strictly speaking, critical current of such a device is proportional to the modulus of cos phi. So it's a maximum when phi is an integer, and a minimum when it's do I have this right? Mod cos phi. I think this should be mod cos phi over 2, in fact. So we have the result is that you get a maximum of your critical current when you have an integral number of flux quanta trapped here, and a minimum when you have a half integral number. So far, so good. This has been seen now for 40 odd years. People have been using these so-called DC squids since time immemorial, basically, ever since Josephson's original work, virtually. This device. What do you do here? You can transpose this device into something which is formally equivalent, where you've just got your junction sitting here, and over here you've got some kind of traditional bulk superconductor. This is also a traditional bulk superconductor, and this would also, in this case, be a traditional superconductor. And this is conceptually equivalent to this here. Now suppose, however, that you have a squid with a so-called D-wave order parameter, which is one which changes sign when I rotate through pi over 2 in the appropriate plane. Then what happens is that you get a lobe of your order parameter which has a plus sign pointing towards this junction, whereas towards this junction is pointing a lobe with the minus sign. So now when you, as it were, do your algebra to add up the phases, it turns out you no longer get this, but you get an extra factor of pi over here. That means, in turn, that the critical current goes as the sine rather than the cosine. That means it has a maximum. Again, I've probably got left a 5 over 2 out here. This means that it has a maximum at an half-odd integral number of flux quanta and a minimum at zero flux integral numbers of flux quanta. And this is basically the design, in effect, of the original experiment by my Illinois colleague, Dale von Harlingen, which actually demonstrated to most people's satisfaction that the cuprates, or at least some cuprates, did have a D-wave order parameter. And it's been since done on various other systems as well. So that's, I think, a very nice direct way of looking at the order parameter. But it's difficult, and it doesn't always work for one reason or another. Okay, so now, so as I say, this I think is conceptually the nicest way of accessing the symmetry of the order parameter. When you can do it, beats all other methods. But you can't always do it. So let's go on to more indirect ways. Now, generally speaking, you can't really measure the gap, the phase of the gap independently of the phase of the order parameter. In fact, it's not even clear what you'd mean by that. So when we talk about measurements of delta, we usually talk about measurements of its modulus. There are a number of ways of measuring the gap directly, for example, by angular resolved photo emission or STM, whatever. There are other, slightly more indirect measurements for measuring through the thermodynamics. Basically, the structure of the gap as I vary over the Fermi surface determines the density of states of the fermionic excitations at low energy. And in fact, formally, the structure is this. The gap comes in because of the dependence of the energy on K. It comes in this way. And therefore, the density of states turns out, if you just interpret, just do a little interpretation of this experiment, of this formula here, it just is proportional to the area of the Fermi surface for which delta is less than E. So let me just go on to that. Yeah, so that's basically an illustration of that. You see, you basically cut off, here is the energy, the minimum energy spectrum, the gap here, it goes like this, say, and you take a surface of constant energy, and basically the density of states at that energy is just the area in here. That's not immediately obvious, but it does come out. And so it turns out that in three dimensions, if you have a point node in three dimensions, the density of states goes as E squared. If you have a line node in three dimensions, it goes as E. And not surprisingly then, in two dimensions, if you have a point node, it goes as E. And if this density of states goes as a particular power of E, well, first of all, let's notice. Of course, in the case of S-wave pairing, all of this would be sort of irrelevant because the gap would just be a constant over the Fermi surface. So the black line, as well as the PEC line, would just be a constant. And in the case of S-wave pairing, there's essentially no density of states at low energies. And that means that all quantities which depend on the normal component are going to decrease exponentially in the zero temperature limit. So for example, the electronic contribution to the specific heat is going to be exponentially suppressed. The Pauli spin susceptibility will be exponentially suppressed. T1, the nuclear spin relaxation time, again, that depends on the electronic degrees of freedom, so that's going to be suppressed, etc. However, if we do have a gap, a node in our gap, then T goes to zero, the specific heat goes as T to the n plus 1, density of states goes as E to the n. This should be London, the London penetration depth. The deviation from its zero temperature value should go as T to the n. Nuclear spin relaxation rate, that involves basically two powers of this. So this is T to the 2n plus 1. The night shift goes as T to the n. So generally speaking, you say if you see a power law in one or more of these quantities experimentally, experimentally a power law, then that's an indication that you've got a node in your gap, and that in turn is an indication you've got exotic pairing. However, you have to be a little careful about the converse statement. Suppose that you actually see everything falling off exponentially. Can you then conclude that it's necessarily S-wave, that is non-exotic? And the answer is, well, in three dimensions you probably can, or at least you can conclude it's either S-wave or a very, very special kind of P-wave state. Because for L greater than or equal to 2 in three dimensions, the gap must always have nodes. However, unfortunately, in two dimensions, and it'll turn out that two dimensions really is quite important for many of the exotic superconductors, then in fact, what you can have is an order parameter, say, which looks like this, exponential IL phi. Now, that is very definitely an exotic form. Nevertheless, the modulus of FK, and therefore the modulus of delta K, is constant. So you'd still get a non-zero energy gap everywhere. You'd still get exponential specific heat, etc. So you have to be quite careful about that kind of inference. Okay, one more diagnostic. This is actually of non-S-wave pairing is the effect of impurities. In a simple BCS pairing, scattering by non-magnetic impurities has little effect, but scattering by magnetic impurities destroys superconductivity as soon as the relevance spin flip scattering rate becomes greater than the gap which would have occurred for a pure system. And that was a very interesting achievement of the early theory. There's a theory by Anderson and others which showed that non-magnetic impurities really would have little effect. And there's a very nice theory by Abrakosov and Gorkov on the effect of magnetic impurities. And that's been rather nicely fitted to experiment and does seem to work in the BCS superconductors. Now, it's not entirely trivial to transpose their arguments to the case of non-S wave pairing, but you can try to do it. And if you give similar arguments for the case of non-S wave pairing, then what turns out is that that is destroyed by any kind of impurity scattering, magnetic or non-magnetic, as soon as the relevant relaxation rate, which crudely speaking is the relaxation rate of a distribution of an extra distribution of quasar particles over the Fermi surface of the same symmetry as the order parameter you're thinking about, as soon as that becomes greater than the original gap. So extreme sensitivity to non-magnetic impurity scattering is an indicator in general of non-S wave pairing. Okay, I think that probably concludes my, yes, okay. So, well, we're going rather slowly, I'm afraid. Okay, that concludes what I wanted to say about diagnostics. Okay, so shall we go on then, a few minutes left, to some specific exotic superconductors. As I say, we're certainly not going to get through the whole list today, but let's at least start on it. The first class of materials I'm going to consider is the alkali fullerides. And in fact, as we'll see, really the only way in which they are in some sense exotic is probably, we're not sure, but probably the only way is that they have a very high transition temperature. Relatively high, anyway. The alkali fullerides have the formula A3C60, where A is some alkali atom. Now, of course, C60 is the famous fullerene or buckyball molecule. It's simply a complex made up of 60 carbon atoms, and they form what's usually called a soccer ball pattern. I'm afraid this doesn't look very much like a soccer ball, but you can perhaps imagine if it's continued, it might look something like one. So it's 20 hexagons and 12 pentagons on the... So it's basically roughly a sphere with these pentagons and hexagons forming its surface. It has icosahedral symmetry. The carbon atom, of course, is... This is wrong. It's 2s2, 2p2, sorry, not 2p4. But in the molecule or the solid, the two 2s states and the two 2p states hybridize to form four sp2 states. And of these, three are used up in the in-plane bonding. And so they're basically saturated, and they don't play a major role in the electronic behavior. The last electron is in a PZ-like state, that is, it's sticking out of the plane. One way of describing the fullerene molecule, which nowadays perhaps a more natural one, is simply to say, well, you take a graphene sheet and just sort of curl it up into a ball. And basically, that's your fullerene molecule. In such a system, you have a so-called highest occupied molecular orbital, homostate, that's fivefold orbitally degenerate, and that of course is usually occupied in the molecule. The lowest unoccupied molecular orbital state, LUMO state, is threefold degenerate, and so that's the one which is in some sense interesting. In the single molecule, this splitting is of the order of 0.6 eV. Okay, so now you take these fullerene molecules, and these of course have been studied to death. Their chemical and spectroscopic properties and so forth are rather well known. Now you put them into a crystal. They form an FCC crystal with a cubic lattice parameter about 14 angstroms, which corresponds roughly to close packing of your buckyballs. And the band which evolves from the LUMO state is now a sort of typical electron conduction band. It has a density of states which looks roughly like this, And what is very interesting and is very rather important for the behavior is that the density of states in the middle of the band is very sensitive to the lattice parameter. Now, that's the pure fullerene crystal. If we now put in some alkali atoms, then we get so-called alkali fullerides, and any intercalated alkali atoms are going to donate their s electrons to the LUMO band, and thereafter they're going to be simply spectators. And if, as those of you who are familiar with the cube probes will recognize, they play a role similar to the so-called charge reservoir atoms in the cube probes. Okay, so so now you have your alkali fullerides. You've got extra s electrons in the LUMO band, and one could look at the normal state properties and so forth. And these, crudely speaking, are consistent with the textbook picture of a half-filled band, a specific heat roughly proportional to T, the Pauli spin susceptibility constant, nuclear spin relaxation time goes as T to the minus one. All of these are the textbook results for an ordinary band metal. Now, one thing, however, which is very interesting is that experiment does confirm that the density of states at the Fermi surface is very strongly dependent on the lattice constant. Right? Is going to play a major role in the behavior. As to the superconducting state, it occurs in the A3C60s, AXC60s, only very close to this special filling, X equals 3, which is exactly the filling at which half of the LUMO band would be filled. Okay. But when it does, then the TCs are way up to something like 40K. That's interesting because, for example, for intercalated graphite, you do get KCC8 does become superconducting, but with a rather miserable transition temperature. And graphene, as far as we know, now I could be wrong here because I haven't been following the literature of the last few months, as it were, but I believe it's correct to say that no one has found bulk superconductivity in graphene to date. So it's quite interesting that when you make these crystals and dope them appropriately, you get these rather high transition temperatures. Now, what is very interesting is that TC increases with the increasing lattice spacing. You can increase the lattice spacing either by, you can decrease it by pressure, you can increase it by substitution. And this is actually a rather large increase here. This is perhaps part of the reason why cesium-3660 has this large TC. And this turns out to be rather consistent with the BCS prediction, because you remember that the BCS prediction for the transition temperature of a superconductor is that TC, apart from a constant, is proportional to the Debye frequency multiplied by this exponential factor here. So now if we assume that V0 is mostly of intramolecular origin and therefore independent, or roughly independent, of the lattice spacing, and then we take into account the fact that the lattice spacing does increase with A, then we can basically explain this. So it looks as if the explanation of this is actually rather straightforward within BCS theory. The A3C60s are strongly type 2. The pair radius, strictly the Pippard coherence length, is about 26 angstroms, which is actually less than two lattice spacings. The London penetration depth varies depending on the compound between 2,000 and 4,000 angstroms. So the fact that this, of course, the fact that this is much greater than this means that you are strongly type 2. What can we say about the pairing state? First of all, both the nuclear spin relaxation time and infrared reflectivity data indicate that the density of states is very small for energy small compared to delta, and that's very consistent with an S-wave picture. I won't mention this because I haven't discussed the so-called Hebel-Slichter peak. This is something which is in a bibliography I've left out. But basically, this is extra evidence for S-state. Unfortunately, you know, there always, just about always, in the case of exotic superconductors, there always seems to be at least one piece of experimental evidence which doesn't fit the pattern. And in this case, it's the temperature dependence of the London penetration depth, which looks like a power law, apparently, at low temperatures. And that really is not, I think, terribly well understood. But the bulk of the experimental evidence seems to be that the pairing state is S state. What about the mechanism? Well, if you replace a carbon-12 by carbon-13, you get an alpha of about 0.4, which will be rather consistent with a phonon mechanism. However, there's one peculiar thing about the alkali fluorides. Generally speaking, if you think about the various energy scales in a typical superconductor, two energy scales that are relevant are the Fermi energy and the Debye energy. And typically, the Debye energy is down by a factor of something like 10 to the 2 or even 10 to the 3 on the Fermi energy. That's not the case in the alkali fluorides. In this case, this ratio can be of order 1, basically. So what this would imply is that even if the basic mechanism is phonon, the details may be rather different from those in the usual BCS theory. And in particular, it isn't even clear that the traditional Elie-Ashberg formalism was very widely applied to deal with effects like this is going to work anymore. Anyway, I think the default explanation, this would not be universally agreed, but I think the default explanation does seem to be that the alkali fluorides are really pretty well described by basic BCS theory with some relevant relevant modifications, for example, due to this factor here, but the strongly molecular structure enables them to avoid the usual limit on TC. So, as was just said, you should perhaps regard the alkali fluorides as not really belonging totally in this class. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say about the alkali fluorides. I should mention that there is a class of theoretical papers in the literature which take the view that this really isn't quite true, that the mechanism of superconductivity is, in some sense, all electronic and so forth. Then I think such theories would have some difficulty explaining the isotope, the fact that you have a non-zero isotope effect. So I think, by and large, people don't believe those, but there has been quite a bit of work done along those lines. So I think one can probably say there's nothing deeply, as far as we know right now, there doesn't seem to be anything very deeply mysterious about the alkali fluorides. That BCS theory does appear to be working reasonably well. Okay, let's see, perhaps I should, yes, I think I have time to go on to the second class, which, if I remember rightly, is the organics, is it? Yeah, organics. Okay, now I hope I've got this this diagram right, because I did actually publish something like this in my book on quantum liquids, and a few years ago I got a note from a chemist who told me that I got it all wrong and that this made no sense for modern chemistry. I think this one is as drawn here, it's okay, hopefully. Okay, so the organics are really rather interesting class of superconductors. Most of them, not all, there are other sort of quasi-one-dimensional types, but mostly the organics are quasi-two-dimensional crystals based on, take a deep breath, bisethylene dithiotetratetraethylfulvalene, and if you do have a chemistry background, you'll know what all that means, but basically I guess the thio refers to all these sulfurs hanging around here. Anyway, you have all sorts of CH2 groups and so forth, which are not indicated explicitly here. Anyway, this is usually called BDT-TDF, or if you can't swallow even that, then it's called ET. So let's call it ET from now on. So the structure is that you have two of these ET molecules, plus an X. An X here is a monovalent anion, for example, iodine-3, copper, NCS, dot, 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 a whole lot of these, maybe a dozen or so different compounds. Now, the interesting point is that you might at first sight think that the conducting layers are going to have something to do with the copper and so forth here, but that apparently is not true. The conducting layers are these sulfur-containing sheets, and the blocking layers are the anions. So you have the anions like this here, And they actually keep apart the ET2 layers here. So these are actually really quite widely spaced, something like 50 angstroms. So it's actually quite, in some sense, quite surprising that such an extremely two-dimensional kind of structure could manage to be superconducting. First sight, you say the fluctuations ought to wash that out, but it doesn't appear to. Incidentally, there's a nasty notational problem which you run into if you ever have to deal with the literature on the organics. In the case of the cuprates, the difficult axis, that is the axis perpendicular to the planes, is universally denoted by the c-axis. In the case of the organics, as shown here, it's denoted by A, and the c-axis is in this direction. That's confusing, but that's the way the history evolved. So. Okay, what do we know about the normal state? First point is that the conduction electron density is low by metallic standards, about 10 to the 21 per cubic centimeter. Very strong anisotropy. The resistance in the direction perpendicular to the ET2 planes is relative to that in the within the planes is something like a factor of 10 to the 2 or even 10 to the 3. And that's entirely comparable to what you get in the cuprates, in fact. Interestingly, you might think that with such a complicated chemical basis, it would be very difficult to make this stuff clean. And it turns out it actually can be made very clean indeed. And this means, in turn, that you can do de Haas van Alphen type measurements on the normal state. And what you find is that you get a band structure which looks something like this. Again, very highly anisotropic in this direction. So very strongly, in fact, very strongly two-dimensional. You have very approximately rotational symmetry around this axis, but it is clearly very, very anisotropic with respect to this axis. What about the superconducting state? Well, TC is typically in the range 10 to 12. I think the maximum is probably about 14 still. Now, the thing is, you not normally think of that as high temperature superconductivity, but there's an interesting observation which a number of people have made, that if you actually try to do some kind of reasonable calculation of the in-plane hopping matrix element, which in some sense is crudely a measure of something like the Fermi energy, it's very small with respect to many other materials, many other exotic superconductors. And therefore, when viewed in its own terms, as it were, the organics really are high-temperature superconductors, or should be regarded as such. They're extreme type 2. HC1 is a few millitesla, whereas HT2 is way up, something like 15 tesla. The estimated pair radius in the plane is about 50 angstroms. Insofar as you can define a pair radius, it doesn't really make a lot of sense to define a pair radius perpendicular to the planes, but if you do, then it's about 5 angstroms, much smaller than the distance between planes. The specific heat seems to be going as going exponentially for T goes to zero, which would rather strongly suggest an S-wave period. As usual, there's always this outlier which doesn't fit in the pattern. The nuclear spin relaxation time appears to go as T cubed, and there's no you don't get the Hubble-Slichter peak which you normally expect in an S-wave superconductor. I would say there's other evidence besides this which seems to indicate S-wave pairing. So I think that is where the majority evidence there. Isotope effect. If you replace carbon 12 by carbon 13, you have an alpha of about 0.1. But if you replace hydrogen by deuterium, you actually get an inverse isotope effect. And that, now an inverse isotope effect is consistent with BCS-like ideas, but it's a rather extreme form of them. And I think the general view is that this is likely to be a rather different kind of effect due to lattice deformation. Right now, I think the organics have been around actually for quite some time, since early 1980s, I guess. And so you'd think that things ought to have been sorted out by now, but I think it's still somewhat up in the air. I would say that the organics do seem to be somewhat BCS-like. On the other hand, the absence of a large isotope effect is a little worrying, and I think the possible view would be that The symmetry is S-wave, but nevertheless, the mechanism is all electronic. I think that's mostly electronic. I think that's a consistent, at least a consistent point of view there. If that does turn out to be the case, as we'll see in the next lecture, in some sense, it's a little surprising because, by and large, all electronic superconductivity seems not to like S-wave. So this would be an exception to that that rule in that case. Okay, so I think I'd better stop there because I'm not going to finish. So what I'll do, I think, is to spend the first part of the next lecture talking about some of the other classes of exotic superconductors. In particular, I'll probably spend a certain amount of time on the cuprates because they are, in some sense, the most exotic. And then I'll try to talk a little about some questions, some obvious questions like, what do all the exotic superconductors have in common? Can we say anything generically about possible theoretical constraints, et cetera, et cetera? And this will be, of course, largely speculative because we really don't have an agreed answer to many of these questions.